Hello everyone and welcome to INDEMYS student channel. My name is Saviera and I come from Indonesia. I am currently working and living in Germany since I had my master degree here. I am also working in a digital supply chain company called Forto in Berlin. And today, I would like to discuss about logistics and introducing you to sustainable logistics. I promise it won't be too heavy for the beginning section of this topic. As logistics is a vast topic that has been existing for quite a long time, many of you even believe that this is a hard topic to begin with. I also thought about it when I was studying and focusing on logistics operation courses. But it is actually simple and even they often appear to our everyday life, from the smallest until company-wide solutions can be done with also logistics. There are two parts in this video. First part of this video, I would like to introduce logistics in easiest way. And second part, I would also like to introduce and encourage more people about sustainable logistics since this is my goal in this video. First of all, let's jump into comparison of logistics and supply chain. People often say logistics are supply chain or supply chain is logistics when introduced. Logistics is a subset of supply chain that operates in an organization that is moving product, as we call it saleable goods, from supplier to customer. While supply chain is the link between the operational work and the company's infrastructure, for example, coordination, strategy and management, processing data and information for better decision making, product delivery and service, as in how to deliver or introduce the product to the market and customer targeted, also taking care of the customer satisfaction, that is called measuring service level, and last, all of the stakeholder that took part, from raw material resources to end sellable product. Although it seems that logistics and supply chain can work independently, but in truth is that they cannot optimally exist without the other. I have a simple example here in everyday life problem that can be solved with logistics thinking. So there is a man, he has been planning to build a house in his hometown, but he has problems with the time and resource and money. The problem in his hometown have not enough resource to let him build up the house in a fast way. This makes cost of building higher since the raw material needed come really slow. And there is his friend coming and giving him a great idea. Why don't you bring some materials from the next town, next door, and the cement from the other town? He thinks it would be faster and cheaper than has to pay labor work for a long time and can actually cover the delivery costs from the next town to his hometown so he can continue building the house with less worry about the money constraint. Yes, I know logistics are way too simple to be placed in one picture, but if I can summarize the point of making good logistics thinking, is the seven pillars of logistics management, that is, to deliver the right product, the right customer, in the right quantity and condition, delivered to the right place and time, and at the right cost. As in the example before, as the young man wants to build a house to implement the building process, planning the raw material needed, labor services, calculation, time cost, everything leads to the seven pillars to make a good, solid logistics thinking. Logistics work together mostly with production and marketing, where logistics are the bridge between the production and marketing by making plant location decision, for example, purchasing decision, product scheduling decision. It also bridges them with marketing in a way customer service standard level are made, pricing, packaging, retail collection. Logistics itself will mostly deal with transporting, inventory scheduling and planning, order processing and material handling. After briefly talking about logistics in small scope, let's talk about globalization in logistics. Logistics, of course, tends to talk more about shipping and delivering in current trend of globalization. Nowadays, people need more things than we were a long time ago. Every product value, quality and prices always comes from the term which country makes it. Like in this picture, every country has its leading points of resources and quality of goods as we share here, known as value of product. The value of international parcel shipments selected countries. Imagine the world's leading companies right now are mostly indulged a lot in logistic operational matter. As you can see in this picture, the value that each country holds the parcel that is from actual demand of people around the world. One exciting part of logistic globalization is the cross-border movement of goods. The reason for this are, first of all, the differences in production costs among different countries. And the second one is efficient transportation. Offshoring is the transfer of specific processes to lower cost location in other countries. Why global logistics? Of course, to minimize supply chain costs, to gain access to materials, and the most important thing is to gain access to markets. Let me give you another example. Your shoes that you wear every day actually are manufactured in different countries. The laces probably made in India, the upper sole from Bangladesh, the bottom sole from Thailand, and even packaging is from Indonesia. Now you might think that your worldwide shoes should be very expensive, but it's actually not. They have precisely calculated and decide where and how much to produce in each country to press the production cost, for example. And they will actually be sold to another continent for higher prices, but as affordable as their targeted market could possibly be interested to buy. Now, I would like to introduce you to one of the widely used mode of transport around the world, that is shipping. Yes. Maritime transportation has been often used since they are known for their vast variety of container capacity with a lot of types and sizes. TEU here is the unit of vessel size. There are 20 TEU, 40-inch TEU, and 40-inch high cube, which can be also known as mega vessel. They can bring bulk goods, refrigerated goods, all of course, in different kinds of container. They can carry a lot of quantity of product, hence large trade throughput. They can also endure great distances, usually cost less, but it's not suitable for fast delivery and it usually has high inventory costs because sometimes customer cannot directly pick up their container goods right after the shipment arrives. So the container needs to stay over several days in the port. This is usually known as inventory cost in shipping. So, why talk about sustainability and what is green shipping? As I explained about globalization from the slides before, globalization's impacted significantly in technological challenges. Global challenges, increasing population, increasing e-commerce, thus resulting in a lot more demand requests to fulfill. And this can be one of the reasons for increasing scarcity of fossil fuels. As you can see in these pictures, I only have one ship as an example of how one can pollute in such a wide area of our ocean. Imagine this in thousands of ships coming and going in a shipping traffic. More ship waste disposal occurs, ballast water discharges, domestic pollutions, especially for the nearby water tunnels such as river and its ecosystems in it, atmospheric pollutions as well. How do we currently overcome this problem? There are four types that we can currently do to help overcome those problem of environmental pollutions. As for policies and plans, IMO, that is short for International Maritime Organization, introduced green shipping as a reference to the use of resource and energy to transport people and goods by ship that complies regulation for maritime transportation. In there, stated norms alongside restrictions and conventions, all still in the goal of reaching customer satisfaction. Market dominance here is a very powerful strategy, especially to push this sustainability topic into the world. Example, by introducing the need for green shipping, global trade user, then it comes the demand that also requires to neutralize the pollutions. We can also optimize the operational work as in eco-friendly route, for example, or also large logistic industries have also been aware of this problem and they are researching eco-friendly shipping technology system design. Sustainable logistics can also be a part of decision making, as in this 3-point questions here, as where to locate production facilities and warehouses. Optimally, of course, locating facilities closer to market potentially reduces emissions. Next one, where to acquire raw material resource, as local sourcing might also help to reduce emissions. Which mode of transport should be used? Example, we can use rail, results in lower emissions compared to the road transport. All of this can be put into account for decision making in order to have more profit or to have less fixed cost. More and more industries have been aware and more sustainable designs are generated, more sustainable resources. All of this represents the term reverse logistic processes, where the point of this were to reuse the container of the product to have more sustainable resource and designs. More research are still following these sustainable topics, as of they are trying to make sustainability more affordable for everyone. I have prepared some examples on one of the points for sustainable logistics decision making, especially on optimized shipping route. The first slide is to show how traditional shipping route took. If you can see on the right corner below is the picture classification of large ship, medium ship and small ship. Large ship mostly will be the size configuration of 40 inch and 40 inch high cube. Medium ship will be 20 inch and small ship up to 20 inch. And in this example, the assumptions without technological improvement, of course, there that the biggest ship produces more pollution and the smaller ships emit less pollution. So, as the route comes, you can identify that small ship need to always go back from its origin, while big ships can most of the time stops at its last destination. But this will be costing much inventory and setup cost. Traditional shipping route will take around 20 days to cover all these demand countries. Now let's see the next slide for the sustainable route example. In this slide, we are only using small ship to send goods to demand countries, but as we want to push the sustainable route points, it also made inventory and shipping costs really high. Why? As you can see, small ships need to go several times from origin to each destination due to less capacity than bigger ships. This creates buffer and waiting time even more and might not be having very good service level on customer satisfaction, with total sailing roughly around 65 days. Looking at these examples, you might have been wondering, how do we do sustainability act proportionally without complicating our service levels and still have enough capacity to expand our businesses? I introduce you to popular sustainability approach that is feasible with every constraint we have for our businesses. I have prepared another example for this. Nowadays, companies from many different backgrounds, not only logistics and transportation, have been actively indulging in sustainability approach in a term called carbon offsetting. Carbon offsetting is where customers can choose to pay a small percentage of the product price for offsetting their emissions, which means, as I have put on an example from a transportation company here, say that I bought a ticket to go to another city, they are using carbon offset price in interactive ways so that customer can also take active part in sustainability action. But how does carbon offsetting really works? There are a lot of outsourced carbon tracking companies out there, like this here, for example, Planetly here or Klima. They are actively calculating your carbon emissions individually based on your mobility promote by car or by plane, for example, based on what you eat, based on your shopping style. From there, they calculated prices that can offset or neutralize your pollution emissions created by your action. In the example again, you just simply click offset your trip to pay 97 cents to neutralize your pollution emissions on that ride. Awesome, right? Where do all the offset money goes from here? Well, they have sustainability packages that allows people to engage transparently and easily through their products. Three that I know that they have rainforest empowerment by planting trees. Some are helping local tribes to easily use eco-friendly stove for reducing smoke pollution, and that usually can also reduce causes fires in the forest. Lastly but not least, by engaging in more development and research on the solar panel technologies. I hope you enjoy my brief explanation about logistics and introduction to sustainability logistics. Here are some examples of companies that have been using carbon offsetting as one of their sustainability approaches. Forto from logistic field point of view, Flixbus from transportation point of view, even Klarna is a digital financing company that also implements carbon offsetting in their products. And even DHL as a big logistics company uses carbon offsetting as well. For closing today's discussion, I would like to refresh our memories regarding what we learned in this video. I will give you several minutes to look back and answer these quick questions, which we will be discussing after. Thank you for taking your time for answering. I would like to discuss the first question. Is logistics and supply chain is the same? The answer is, logistics is the subset of supply chain, though one cannot exist optimally without the other. Goes to second question, what is the main goal of logistics? The goal is moving goods from supplier to customer in whichever form. Since we are living in a modern world now, everything can be moved, for example, e-banking and digital credit cards. Third question, do we need to implement all 7 pillars of logistics? Even one of the 7 pillars are not fulfilled, the logistic chain will not be optimally stable. Imagine you built a house, but only 3 out of several 7 pillars are used. It will not hold long. Last question of the day, what is the most popular way for companies to take on sustainability action? Carbon offsetting, where customers can choose to pay a small percentage of the product price for offsetting their emissions. Thank you for watching and see you again soon!